You've been with us all the way. You know that I indicated earlier, Jerry Jarrett, owner of Jarrett Promotions, was supposed to be here right at the top of the show. He was running a little late. I'm glad you made it before the show was over with, Jerry, because you got a big announcement for him.
Yeah, I sure do, Lance. But right before I came out here, Randy Hale said to make it real brief. We were tight on the program today. So I'll try to make it as brief as possible, but it's so significant, it's hard for me to get in a hurry when I'm talking anyway. Jerry Lawler has been my friend. I've been a big fan of his, even when I was years ago when I was wrestling against him. You know, you develop a respect for your opponent. Mm. And because Jerry's one of the great ones, and I don't have to remind the people, Jerry is probably the only wrestler that I have ever heard of, or certainly wrestling today, that has wins over every former champion and every current champion that there is in the wrestling business today and during his wrestling career. And that's a unique distinction without being the champion.
The champion. Right?
It's been one of the great frustrations of his life. I've been with him all of his wrestling career, and I know how bad he wanted that title and how bad we all wanted it for him. But wrestling belts are something that sometimes evade people, no matter how talented they are or how good they are. And Jerry's reached a point in his life when he came to me and he said, Jerry, I want one more match. And if you can get in touch with the Gagne organization, if you can line up a match with Henning, I either want to be the champion or I'm going to let that be my retirement night. Now, of course, this was startling to us, and after I can't go into all of the conversation we had concerning it. But Jerry's reached that point that he either wants to climb that very tip top of the mountain or wants to sit back and let somebody else do it. So we as a company, when we're faced with these kind of things, have no choice. It's not a pleasant event to promote. But because of our relationship with Jerry and because I know what's in his heart, we're going to do the best we can to do it. Now, the match has been signed. It'll be Jerry Lawler against Curt Hennig, and it'll be May the 9th. The thing that we're going to try to do is bring in some people that night to make it almost This Is Your Life, Jerry Lawler, if that's possible. I don't know who all we can get. One thing for sure we're going to do, we're going to have a party for the fans. We're going to set up what we call a golden circle, the first three or four, depending on the demand, three or four rows of ringside. And those fans, after the matches, will have some refreshments and a party. And it'll either be one of two things. It'll either be a victory celebration party like you've never seen, or it'll be a farewell to Jerry Lawler party. Mm. And Lance, I know how special Jerry is to you and how much of a part of your life he's been. And I wouldn't make any bets, but let's just hope with everything we've got in it that party after the matches May the 9th is a celebration party.
Yeah, really.
Randy wants me to hurry, so I'll be telling you more about it later on.
Okay, that's May the 9th, just so we got the
May
date in mind.
Ninth.
Okay, Jerry, thanks for being down here and bringing us that news, I think. That statement made by Jerry Jarrett, owner of the CWA, set off the stage of one of the great nights ever in professional wrestling. Hello again, everybody. This is Lance Russell, and tonight we have the honor of being able to tell you a little bit of the preceding events and the events that took place of a new champion. Jerry the King Lawler, he was a man that had had every opportunity in the world to go for the world title. He deserved it. He earned it and faced as many champions as any one wrestler ever had in the history of wrestling. When Jerry Jarrett made the announcement that Lawler had made the decision he was either going to win the world heavyweight title on one final shot against the AWA champion Curt Hennig or hang him up, it certainly set the stage. And it was one of those interesting situations where not only did the fans rise to the occasion, but the dignitaries. There were the awards from the mayors, the city mayor, the county mayor, from the city council, proclaiming it Jerry Lawler Day.
Well, I think what I want to do first is whatever this guy's name is that's going to drag into town
Kurt,
Monday.
Kurt Henning, yeah.
Kurt Henning?
Yeah.
How old is this guy?
The dirty rat is a young guy. I think he's about 24.
24? Well, I tell you what, I just wanted to, on behalf of the citizens of this community, let him know that he has one heck of a fight coming Monday. And on behalf of the citizens of this community, let you know that we are totally behind you. We want to make sure that this little wimp coming into town doesn't beat our own king here in Memphis. And we're going to proclaim this Monday Jerry the King Lawler Day, as it almost is every day. And we want that guy to know that before he comes in here, that you're the king of Memphis, that you're in charge of this place, and he's not about to come to our city and beat our king. And because of this proclamation, a couple of statements that should be made. It says, whereas Jerry the King Lawler enjoys one of the most colorful and exciting careers in both wrestling and in Memphis' sports history. And it is only fitting and proper that the office of the mayor of the city of Memphis, on behalf of the people of Memphis, give due recognition to such an outstanding citizen and athlete for his many significant contributions to our city. Now, therefore, I, Richard C. Hackett, mayor of the city of Memphis, do hereby proclaim this Monday night as Jerry the King Lawler Day and night in our city, and urge all of our citizens to join with me in saluting this great ambassador, this great athlete, this great athlete, this great... I'm going to say that again, Jerry. That's what you're going to do to him.
Yes, exactly.
He won't be able to talk when you get through with it.
That's good.
Now, therefore, I, Richard C. Hackett, mayor of the city of Memphis, do hereby proclaim this Monday Jerry the King Lawler Day in our city, and urge all of our citizens to salute you, wishing you the very best, and we insist that you keep this crown and the belt in Memphis. King?
Thank you very much.
Good luck to you.
Thank
Not
you.
That you need it.
The only thing that I could think of that would assure a victory for me, you know, there have been a lot of famous wrestling managers and tournament in, around the country for different wrestlers. Now, if I had you in my corner, to, as you say, give me a few pointers throughout the night, let me know when things look a little shaky there, I could almost assure a victory.
I'll be there. I'll be there Monday night to make sure this guy doesn't come into town and take the crown away from our king.
Well, I want to thank you. And I want to thank everybody involved with this. And, you know, there have been a lot of wrestlers who've come out of Memphis and supposedly gone on to bigger and better things. But I've always been very content to stay here because there may be bigger cities in Memphis, but there aren't any better.
That's right, Jerry.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
It's a distinct pleasure of mine on behalf of Mayor of Shelby County, William M. Morris, Jr., to present to you a proclamation by the mayor. And at this time, I'd like to read it to you. It says, proclamation by the mayor, whereas Jerry Lawler has served as a goodwill ambassador for Shelby County for the past 15 years through his involvement with the professional wrestling circuit, and whereas throughout his colorful career, Jerry the King Lawler has won numerous titles, bringing much glory to his hometown and to the sport of professional wrestling, and whereas Jerry Lawler has served as a prominent spokesman for many local charities and community causes, lending his name and support to fundraising efforts to create a better quality of life for many of his fellow citizens. And whereas, it is much regret that we acknowledge his statement that he will retire from the wrestling ring on May 9th should his bid to win the world championship title be unsuccessful. We want to thank Jerry the King Lawler for the many years of entertainment he has already given our citizens and wish him well in his championship bout. Now, therefore, I, William N. Morris, Jr., Mayor of Shelby County, Tennessee, do hereby proclaim Monday, May 9th, 1988, as Jerry Lawler Day in Shelby County in honor of outstanding citizenship who has given so much of himself to his community. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused the seal of Shelby County to be affixed the 4th day of May, 1988, William N. Morris, Jr., Shelby County Mayor.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
And I have also a medallion from the mayor,
all right,
which I'd like to present to you. Let you look at it. And on the back of it has an inscription, which I'd also like to read to you.
Okay.
Memphis Shelby County have been reborn, and the new community on the fourth bluff of the Mississippi River attests to the power of the united people and shared dream for the future. Together, our citizens are moving Shelby County towards its destiny with courage, with enthusiasm, and with a confidence that we cannot fail. William M. Morris, Jr., Mayor of Shelby County, and I know that you cannot fail either. Thank Bring you. The championship home.
Okay. Thank you very
Congratulations.
Much.
Congratulations.
Jerry, I'm sorry I couldn't be with you today. I'm sorry I'm not going to be able to be in town for today's show, but I think it's very important that I came by to send you this message. As chairman of the Economic Development Committee of the Memphis City Council, it's my charge to make sure that we continue this great progress that we're making in economic development in Memphis. And it gravely concerns me, Jerry, that if you lose this match on May the 9th, Monday night, you've got to retire and leave town. And I think you don't understand the significant impact that you could have on the economic development of this city, Jerry, if you retire. And I'm calling on all your fans out there, Jerry, to come on out and support you on May the 9th. The city council, we feel that it's so significant that you win this match and that you don't retire, that we're declaring May the 9th, Jerry Lawler Day. We encourage all those citizens and fans in this great community to come out to the Mid-South Coliseum and root on Jerry Lawler, and let's not let him retire. He's not ready, and we're not ready, and Memphis can continue to grow and be the great city that it is. Thanks, Jerry. Good luck, buddy.
Jerry Lawler, deserving of every attention that he got on that particular day. Here was a man who was not just a professional wrestler. He was a personality. He's remembered throughout the entire nation, though he was not seen on television at that time, for place in the life of Jerry Lawler. There were others inside the ropes. Who will ever forget the 60-minute draw when he battled the great Jack Briscoe for the title? Harley Race was just as tough as his reputation was that preceded him. Jerry Lawler went against him for the world title. And then on several occasions, Lawler had the opportunity to try Nick Bockwinkel, the legendary AWA World Heavyweight Champion. He also went against the Canadian who held the same title, Rick Martel. The notorious Terry Funk, NWA World Heavyweight Champion, was an opponent. And most recently, Lawler had faced Curt Hennig, the AWA World Heavyweight Champion, where his father was instrumental in retaining the belt for Curt Hennig. It was off of that match that Lawler earned and received another shot at the World Heavyweight title. And now, it became more pressing. Either win it or retire. Let's go to the ring, May the 9th, Mid-South Coliseum, Memphis, Tennessee, a near-capacity crowd gathered to see Jerry Lawler face Curt Hennig for the world belt. Memphis, Tennessee is ready for this action. It's not too often you have a situation where somebody puts it all on the line and says, do or die. That's the way it is with the King tonight. Curt Hennig facing a hometown crowd, which is nothing new for the world champion. You got to get out and get to the other folks' home ground. And that's what Hennig is doing tonight. Not the first time he's been here. And many of the locals have developed a healthy disrespect for the world champion. Hennig starts out with a little show of strength, pushing Lawler down to the deck. Fabulous Jackie Fargo saying, come on, guys, now let's have a good wrestling. Find one to talk. The rowdy falls that he was involved. And again, Hennig pushes Lawler back down to the deck. Hennig kind of a surprise with Kenny D working in his corner. Kenny D is a guy that took a payoff to nail Lawler in the eyes with powder in a previous match with Eddie Gilbert. And look at Lawler bring it back to Hennig and show him that Hennig is not the only one that can fire somebody around that ring. Lawler turned him all the way over. Hennig with an 8-pound weight advantage on Lawler. Got a couple of inches in height on him. On the ropes, Fargo backs Hennig up and says, hey, come on, Howard. Little lecture coming from Jackie Fargo. Often imitated, never duplicated. Fabulous Jackie Fargo, chosen by the fans for the special referee for this one. And once again, the presence of the referee as Lawler is backed up. And again to the corner. Whip! Hennig blasted with a right hand. And another right. And Jackie figures that's everyday wrestling move, and Hennig back with a right to the midsection. To the head, Lawler reverses it, goes downstairs, nails him with a right upstairs. And Hennig dumped down on the floor. Over the top rope, bounced off the ring apron and unceremoniously on the concrete floor. Fargo telling Kenny D to get back in the corner and don't be running out of it. Jackie said, no, I believe it was an open hand, Curt. Check with Hennig's jaw, he'll tell you. Oh, Lawler rushed in to follow up with that right. Hennig came flying out. Caught him with a punch clothesline. Dumps Lawler down on the deck. Kicking away at him. Fargo hollering, get out of the hair. Lawler stops Hennig. Three left. Referee does step in at that point. That just was to give Lawler running room, I guess. He backed up and raced over with that right hand. Oh, what was this? Kenny D reached out and grabbed Lawler's leg. Lawler throws Hennig off and says, time. Oh, we may have another little battle here. crawling Kenny D up to the ring apron. Dunks him in. Pounds him one. There's the old atomic knee that the fabulous one was so famous for. Tells him to get out of there and stay out. Fargo is telling, I believe, Kenny D to hit the road. Back to the dressing room. That's it.
It looks like Jackie Fargo is telling Kenny D to get out of here.
Get out of here. That's exactly what he's telling him. And Kurt Hennig saying, what do you mean running my manager off? Well, this is the kind of referee. I know that it's not to Hennig's choosing, but it's the kind of referee they needed. A no-nonsense guy who can back up what he had to say. The emotion so high in this instance. With Jerry Lawler and Kurt Hennig going for the world title, Hennig defending against the challenger, Lawler. Minutes into the action, and Kurt Hennig with a standing side headlock, center of the ring. That's probably the closest we've had to straight out wrestling move. A lot of fist shaking and pounding, kicking and stomping. Hennig with an excellent base, widespread legs. About 54 minutes to go in the action, so plenty of time in this world title. Lawler trying to shake it, and Hennig grabbed the hair. Look at Fargo counting. He evidently got Kurt for using the hair once, and he didn't like the way he broke, so he broke him a couple of more times. Steps in and reads a little riot act to Lawler. Fargo has, I think, done a very good job up to this point. Only at one point did he kind of do a little cheerleading for the King. Ooh, nice move. Kurt Hennig whips around. Got that waist lock on the wall. Lawler looking to see whether he can grab a leg. Nope, Hennig has got his legs spread outside Lawler. So that Lawler didn't have any target to go for. Lawler with one giant step, may I. Woo, nice knob, and look at Hennig, nice block. Champion. Showing his wares. Lawler again tried to hook a leg. No way. Once more, Lawler tried to take him over, but Hennig. Nice block and stuff. King back up on his feet again. The champion holds to that waist lock on him. Now Lawler trying to muscle it out. Wow, starting to get into it. There's Jerry go. First 3 minutes of action. Both of these guys have settled into more classic wrestling than they were the fist throwing. Part of it may be due to the fact that Fargo was right on top of it as referee. Let each one of them go so far and then call the halt for it. Standing side headlock with Henning. Waller contemplating, I'm sure. Not the best position for Kurt. It's a little dead ahead, and Waller has more opportunity. Might be able to go for a scoop here. Watch him. 10-minute mark in the action with 50 minutes to wrestle. The world title and a career on the line. Waller picks him up and drops him to great time. Jerry outside going up the turnbuckles to the top rope and misses as he came off. Henning follows it up, dropped right in behind with a knee down. Kurt Henning stomped him right in the midsection, picks the feet up again, rolls him over, looks like he may be going into, Boston Crab. Henning with good height, Waller is hollering tight. But it's true, Henning did grab him to finally complete the roll. Kurt, good position. Not too many of the guys, but the real pros that use the Boston Crab. Takes a good combination of getting the legs right and sitting now where you can really put the pressure on the spine. Henning now. Looked like he slipped a hand out on the rope. Maybe to get a little extra leverage.
The 12-minute mark into the action, Kurt Henning with a Boston Crab. Couldn't get the proper power, he thought. He grabbed a rope, and Jackie Fargo broke it real quick. The King, who was held in that Boston Crab for a considerable length of time by Kurt Henning. Now Henning hops on as he straddles Lawler from behind, chin locks him, and pulls that head back up, bending him up. Henning with about an 8-pound weight advantage. We are 12 and a half minutes into the action, and it has been a give-and-take match. Been a dandy, Dave, hasn't it?
Boy, it sure has. And Lawler got just what he wanted with a referee, too. Jackie Fargo calling it right down the middle. A couple of the calls have gone against the King. A couple of them have gone for the King. But Jackie is right there on top of the action, something you like to see in a championship match like this. Well called on both sides of the ring.
Jackie Fargo leans in tight to be certain that there was no choking, and look at Henning on a reversal right across the jawbone on Lawler. He has really bending it up. Lawler on the ropes. That is a break right there, but Jack has not moved in to break it up. Now he does. Lawler leans over the bottom rope, and referee Jackie Fargo trying to get him to break right now. They're coming out on the floor. Look out. As Kurt Henning with Lawler slams him into the ring post. And Lawler, with the side of his head busted open where he hit that ring post, blood running down out of his right eye. And Henning follows it up with a foot to the head. Kurt Henning, the world heavyweight champion, the King. Not the first time he's had to battle with blood in his eyes, but boy, he is going against a premier one. As Kurt Henning knocks him slam his head into the metal railing. Lawler, bleeding from the side of the head. And referee Jackie Fargo saying, do you want me to stop it? Lawler said, hold it, hold it. I'm not giving it up. Henning pulls him up on the ring apron and headbutts him right in that right eye. The King having a letdown 12 minutes into it as Curt Henning has really been taking advantage of him and getting rougher and rougher. He gouges his eye on the top turnbuckle. Henning, sensing what kind of competition he's got, pulling out all the stops, Davey.
Boy, he sure did. He ran him right into the ring post down here, cut him open, and he hasn't let up since. He is going after that right eye. In the midsection. Henning with the big right hand. Henning just kicked him down on the floor. Lawler lying on the concrete floor. Jackie Fargo, the referee over here, he starts the count. Henning down on the floor looking for him.
Going after him as he picks Lawler up. Boy, Lawler's face is a bloody mess. The strap is down. The King was knocked back into the action by Henning, and now he's trying to knock him all the way out of it as he dropped him on that metal railing. The crowd at ringside hollering to Jackie, come on, Jerry, come on, Jerry, hold in there. And Lawler, facing the count by Jackie Fargo, falls backward onto the floor, but rolls under the bottom rope as the count got to the count of nine. Henning, big chop on Lawler. Whip across the ring. Lawler kicked back down on the floor by Curt Henning. He's going for the count. And the referee says, break it up. And what's Jackie saying, using the fist?
Yeah, use the fist. He hit him with a fist. And Jackie said, I'm not counting him out because you hit him with a fist to put him there.
You pointed out, too, Dave. Jackie has been, we think, very objective in this. He jumped on both of them for the infractions of the rules. He hasn't gotten in too much, but he has been there when he should have been there. Lawler grabbed, throws, Curt Henning throws Lawler right in. To Jackie Fargo. Fargo down, hitting with a pile driver. Puts him down, covers him up. Fargo rolls over. Count of one, two, and Lawler kicked out before the three.
He got the two, and he almost got the third count, but Lawler, with that bit of energy, all of a sudden was able to kick out of it before the three count fell. Lawler's still going here. His eye is cut open, his right eye is cut, and Henning has really been beating the skew out of him here the last couple of minutes. Henning up on the rope, Lawler on his feet. It's Lawler with a right fist, and Henning.
With another one. Henning, Lawler connect at the same time with right hand. Down they go. Jackie counts one, two. Remember, if if there's a double count out. Lawler covers. Count of one, two, and Henning beats the count by a split second just before the 20-minute mark.
Well, the King just barely survived an earlier count, as he was able to break out of it just before a three count. Kurt Hennig right there almost had lost the world title to Lawler, but at the last instant, he was able to get the shoulder up. It's Hennig again with the advantage now. Lawler on the mat. Hennig drops down. The shoulders are down. Whoop. Hair pulling. And Jackie Fargo's not going to start the count.
Explain that one to me.
He said that Hennig pulled Lawler's hair when he dropped down there.
Kurt Hennig blasts Lawler again. Goes into a front face lock. Looks like he's going for a suplex. Puts Lawler over and goes immediately for the cover one. Count of two, and Lawler counts out. And now Hennig is getting upset with Jackie Fargo. Well, he was saved on what was a questionable count. I'm sure Lawler would question it earlier. So it has been pretty well down the middle. And now with a sleeper hold. And what is this? Hennig told a break because he had Lawler's hair. Jackie says break again. Hennig breaks and goes right back at it.
See that particular instance of hair pulling, but Hennig has this habit of when he's going to hit Lawler, he'll grab him by the hair first. Well, I think Jackie is calling him on that. A lot of times that doesn't get called in a match.
Well, here's in this one, when he has a sleeper, you can see his right hand is on the forehead prior to Jackie's breaking it up. He was using the hair to anchor it.
Now, I see what you're talking about. He's trying to do it again here.
Boy, look at the blood streaming off of Lawler down Hennig's arm. Jerry trying to fight his way back to his knees. So much riding on this for the King. If he cannot wrest the crown away from Kurt Hennig, Lawler will hang it up and end an incredible 15-year career in professional wrestling. Jackie Fargo, as Hennig refuses to let go of that sleeper, he slipped up on his back. Lawler still not ready to give it up. He's on his feet and alive, I can't say well. And Lawler falls face first into the corner, driving Hennig's head into the top turnbuckle. And for the moment, it saved the King.
Things are not looking good, though, for Lawler. Lawler cut. He's hurt. He's not moving well in the ring. Hennig looks like the stronger of the two at the moment.
I think the action outside the ring, when Hennig slammed him to the ring post three times, hit him on the middle retaining fence around the ring, really is what took it out. The referee tells Hennig to back up while Fargo looks at the eye. He was tempted to stop it right then and there. Look at Hennig blast that eye. Whoa! Hennig is saying ring the bell, but the referee hadn't said ring the bell. Hennig is just blasting him unmercifully on that eye. And the referee keeps checking it, but Lawler stops Fargo from giving them 24, 27.
Incredible! A new world heavyweight champion, the King, Jerry Lawler, has just beaten Kurt Hennig. world champion.
In the air, the great belt signifying the world champion, Jerry Jarrett, promoter Eddie Marlin. They're all up there as the king turned what looked like sure defeat into a victory. And Lawler, in 24 minutes, 27 seconds, raises the hand with the belt, signifying he is the new heavyweight champion of the world.
What a mess.
Incredible battle. I think that in balance, you would have to say that Henning was ahead on points coming into the final maneuver. It ultimately ended up when Lawler got a catapult, slung Henning into the top turnbuckle, knocked him out, and covered him for the 1-2-3 in 24 minutes, 27 seconds. What a victory for Jerry Lawler's Mid-South home, Memphis, Tennessee, as the Coliseum at capacity crowd was here to witness a hometown boy finally obtain something he had been trying to all of his life. Jerry Lawler, the new champion. Lawler looking across the ring right now at Curt Hennig. Bill Dundee congratulating him. He's had so many hard battles with Dundee, but Dundee showing his respect. Eddie Marlin, Jackie Fargo, and on the other side of the ring, in contrast, Dave,
all alone,
the vanquished Curt Hennig.
Hennig, it was quite a battle. I mean, Hennig gave it all he had, but Lawler beat him. He pinned those shoulders right in the middle of the ring. 1-2-3, no doubt about it. Curt Hennig is now the former AWA World Heavyweight Champion.
And Hennig crawls back to the ring, still holding his eye, where Hennig hit that top turnbuckle, catapulted by Lawler, and that is what led to the final victory. How about it, Jackie? Referee Jackie Fargo.
He did it on his own. What a great night.
What a happy guy, because he is instrumental in Lawler's wrestling career.
Okay, we're in the dressing room right now with the new world heavyweight champion, Jerry the King Lawler, who just won the world title from Curt Hennig. Now that some of the noise has died down and some of the well-wishers have died away, you're about ready to go to the shower, Jerry. It occurs to me that we've watched you from the front end, and it's been a 14-year quest for this world heavyweight title. It has been a dream and an obsession with you. Can you put it into words how it feels now to finally be the world champion?
Lance, it's something that I guess probably 1,000 times throughout those 14 years, I've thought about what I would say in this situation, what it would feel like to hear you, Lance Russell, call me the world heavyweight champion, and what I would feel like and what I would say. And now that it actually happens, and I'm sitting here with the World Heavyweight Championship belt in my hands, it's something I don't even know if I can put it into words, because it's like it's like the realization of a dream. It's like a lifelong quest, climbing a mountain that you thought you'd never get to the top of, and then finally realizing here I am on top of that mountain.
Jerry, I got to say that in times when you've had title shots, you've been 60 minutes with the great Jack Briscoe, and I could name bouts and bouts. There were times when it looked like you might have given up, but you never did. You never quit hoping for the championship.
Oh, no, I never quit hoping. And that's, when you give up, Lance, it's all over. There are old sayings, and they don't get to be old sayings unless they ring true. It's quitters never win, and winners never quit. And the thing that makes you, gives you that little extra bit of incentive to not quit, and, you know, it may sound corny, but I don't care. It's the truth as far as I'm concerned, is the fans. We had, Lance, close to about 9,000 people out there tonight. And I'll be perfectly honest with you. There was a time, several times. First time, right after that pile driver, mm-hmm. I thought it was over. Mm-hmm. Second time, when May busted my eye open, early in the match, it messed up the vision in my right eye. I thought it was over then. But I knew deep down inside that if I quit, not only am I letting myself down, but I'm letting down all those 9,000 people and a lot, many thousands of others that weren't able to be here tonight. I'm letting all of those people down. And those are the people, Lance, that make us, not just me, but any athlete. You're absolutely nothing. I don't care how big and how great you think you are. You're only as good as your fans. You're absolutely nothing without them. And there's no way that I've come this far and got that close that I was going to let them down tonight.
The world champion, Jerry Lawler.
Thank you, Lance. That sounds really, really good to hear you say that.
A special night, May the 9th. Before the outcome of that match was known, so many of Jerry Lawler's admirers had come to the Coliseum to participate in what they thought was going to be a retirement party for the King. Let's go in and see how they received the new world champion.
What a night, huh? Wow! Oh, I gotta tell you. Do you know how long we waited? Yeah, you know, because most of you have been right there with us all the way waiting. And I want to tell you one thing. For the Jerry Promotions, thank you very much for your support. I'm delighted you were here, and I hope that you feel like that you were, because finally, after a 15-year quest, son of a gun, it happened. We have a homegrown champion right now.
It's been 14 long years that I've waited to hear that man right there call me the world heavyweight champion. It sounds, I don't know about you, it sounds good to me. Thank you. All I can tell you is that for a long, long time, all those 14 years, a lot of you people know how many title shots I had, and it was beginning to feel like I was climbing a mountain that I was never going to reach the top, but all of a sudden, right here tonight, let me take this off where everybody can see it.
Yeah.
Here's the top of the mountain right here. I just want to say, and I know this may sound a little corny, but I don't care because it's the truth. Myself, every wrestler, every athlete are absolutely nothing without you people, the fans, and I want to thank you for being here tonight. This is our belt right here in Memphis, and the belt. Thank you.
Ah, what a night. And there will never be another one like that in the life of Jerry Lawler. 14 years of severe struggling, recognized as one of the top wrestlers in the nation, internationally recognized, but he had never been able to hold or obtain the world heavyweight title. It all came to fruition on May the 9th, Memphis, Tennessee, at the Mid-South Coliseum. Well, that's part of the story. We mean that the future is ahead. How long will Lawler be able to hold the title? I'll tell you one thing, for those who try to take it from him, beware. He'll use any means, I am sure, to be able to keep it. Jerry Lawler, the King, and his most proud title, the World Heavyweight Champion.
Coliseum, Randy Hills and Lance Russell at ringside. This in a cage, Jerry the King Lawler versus the Universal Heartthrob Austin Idol, the Southern Heavyweight Championship at stake. The match will be hair versus hair. Anything goes. And if Idol does not win, he will refund the price.
Where they have ever had anybody guarantee an admission refund on a certain outcome of the match. And that's what it is on this match here. History in the making, another first for great championship wrestling out of the Mid-South area. Eddie Marlin has booked it, hair versus hair. Austin Idol has put up over $50,000 to guarantee that if he does not defeat Lawler and shave his head, his hair will go, and he will refund the money of every person in the Mid-South Coliseum. And let me tell you, we are talking over $50,000. Over there, dangerously going at it. And the ref, oh, look at this, Lawler right behind Idol, grabs him, slams him into the door. You want it, you got it. And Idol running from Lawler, trying to get out the door. Center of the ring as Jerry Lawler pursues him relentlessly. Randy, normally we talk about Jerry being a slow starter. Boy, he obviously is pumped up for this one because he is off and running.
Off and running's right. We both talked to him before the match, and he is geared up and ready to go. And he has Austin Idol right from the beginning going. The King is fired up. Hair versus hair, and Idol and Lawler two do battle in this brand new.
Substantial cage directly in front of us. Lawler going for the pile driver, and Idol gets away from it. The King, who defeated Idol in their last outing for the Southern Heavyweight title. That was a chain match in which Lawler showed him what a chain match his style was. Paul Dangerly screaming, "Give me the key, give me the key." No way. And Idol being blitzed by Lawler. Jerry looks like he's busted. Wild close match, kicking away at Jerry Lawler. Ah, Jerry slipped a little back kick in there of his own. Pounds Austin. Just past the 5 minute mark in this match. Wrestling, Austin Idol, the King Jerry Lawler. Idol looked like he may have been going for a chain, Randy, but Lawler tied him up.
It looked like it to me, and I think he has it, Lance. Yeah, he nails Lawler, the King down.
It wasn't a chain. It looked like it was like a roll of dimes or something. The catch it before the match. It's an anything goes match. Idle dropped with an elbow down on the King. Count of one, count of two, count of three, but knew Lawler's shoulder was up at the 10-minute mark. 10 minutes passed in this cage match. As Jerry Lawler that close to losing it. Idle has had a couple of very close spots. Watch this one. Idle again on the rope. But Austin is staggering a little with that right knee. He is favoring it, and he misses. Lawler out of the way as he drops with the elbow. Now the King. Gonna spear him. He nailed him right in the head. Idle stumbling, falling around. Lawler is hurt himself. Came right off the rope, speared Idle.
Okay.
the king. Powder from Paul Dangerly outside the cage, right in the eyes of Lawler. But remember, the referee being out of it won't help Idol get a pin, 1, 2, 3 either. Calhoun grabbing his neck. There's a cover by Idol, but who's to count? Where's the referee? He's hurt. absolutely and dumbfounded. And the King, who's been such a prominent part of not only all of professional wrestling, but of his hometown, Memphis, Tennessee, is having his hair shaved off in the center of the ring. Congratulating.